material for the introduction. I will need somebody to change the slides, I believe, actually. There's no device on the desk here, and so. Not yet. First of all, I'd like to say just a couple of things. I'd like to acknowledge the work of Dr. Koo and her team in organizing this symposium. I didn't organize it, they organized it, I just happened to be the chairman. They were very hard to put this on. Hopefully that in fact the rain has not put off the rest of the audience and will actually appear later in the morning, even a little bit draggled, possibly. The purposes of this symposium is really to, in fact, showcase the work of the faculty of Creative Multimedia and others for the benefit of prospective students for a postgraduate career. I gather that some of you present, I can probably guess who you are potential future students who may be thinking about, as it were, signing up for a postgraduate degree. Could I just briefly state that, in fact, that the postgraduate degrees in this faculty and, in fact, the university in general fall under two sorts of categories, those which are, in fact, by research directly, and those which are by taught courses. This faculty has, obviously, PhD and master's programs by research in many different areas of interest. Also, it has two taught master's degrees, which are in knowledge management and e-learning technologies. These degrees themselves can lead in the future on to, for example, registration for a PhD. So they are a route to, as it were, research. My purpose this morning, or I was asked this morning, to talk about my experience as a researcher. I'm not the oldest member of staff of the university, and I'm probably not the oldest researcher, but I actually have done research actively for the last 45 years. So it means I've done a lot. Can I have the first slide? I better put some of my credentials, therefore, in research. I started as a researcher in 1969, and the first areas of research I was involved in for the first 10 years were for a multidisciplinary consultancy run by two of my ex-professors as a private institution. This had a very big impact on the way that I view research, because the research that we did then primarily was for government agencies, government ministries and departments. So the first four, five areas of research were of that nature. I then had a small hiatus in research activity because I took a teaching post, and in fact during that first period of time I did very little in the way of research. But then I ultimately moved to Singapore, and in Singapore I then recommenced research work again towards the end of the 1990s. In Singapore, and then subsequently in the University of Malaya, I did several research areas, and you can see that in fact that the areas of my research interest at that time were primarily in what is generally called building physics, lighting, acoustics, energy conservation. Next slide, please. From 2001 onwards, the research activities conducted within Multimedia University, firstly under the grant from Motorola, and then subsequently funded research from GMR&D, etc., from the Ministry of Higher Education. And the areas of research I was involved in have gradually changed over that period of time. So I still have a slightly Walter Mitty type existence in that I was Professor of Architecture at the University of Malaya and still examine architectural students and take architectural PhDs, so in addition to the areas which I'm now involved in. I make this point because in fact that there is a tendency for many researchers to feel that they are very restricted in the area which which they do research. And one of the aspects of research which I'm going to talk about is curiosity. So in fact, people become more curious about things, and actually they evolve as researchers. So what you start out researching, maybe not what you finish researching at the end of your career. Next slide, please. I've also acted as an expert and done consultancy work in addition to research directly. Predominantly, these are in Malaysia, but you can see, as I say, slightly more Tumiti-ish, having been a member of the expert design panel for International Energy Agency. I also, in fact, represent Malaysia with regard to e-learning, so I tend to be something of a butterfly in research in that sense, that I'm actually involved in very different areas. And these are some of the consultancies. Next slide, please. Okay, so I'm just going to talk about very briefly three themes. Firstly, the PhD population, as I see it, over the last 5 decades. Something about research and teaching and the relationship between the two. And then finally, something about the motivation for doing research. Next slide. I wanted to, first of all, give an indication as to the way in which, in fact, PhDs as a qualification has changed over time in universities. These examples I've given are entirely directly from my own experience, but in fact I think they are indicative of what the situation was at that time. In the 1970s, for instance, I was part of what I describe as an elite in UK university, in fact actually the premier university for architecture in the United Kingdom at University College, London. And at that time, out of a staff of 40, there were 5 PhDs, of which 3 were chair professors. In the 1980s, working in a more average UK university at that time, the department had 2 PhDs on a staff of 40. So you can see there that in fact the number of PhDs as academic staff was very small, very small. In fact, PhD degrees were, in fact, a rather unusual qualification. So much so that, in fact, if you went to America and you had a PhD, they always referred to you as doctor rather than professor, because everybody's professor in America. And a doctorate was an unusual qualification by comparison. So it may be difficult to perceive at this stage that, in fact, that actually PhD holders were something of a rarity in universities at that time. Again, in the 2000s, still in, this is the University of Manchester, Department of Architecture and Planning, only 5 PhDs and a staff of 60, which is, again, indicative of, in fact, the extent to which PhDs were not present. However, all of these departments did a lot of research. So, in fact, PhD was not, in fact, actually a prerequisite for doing research at that time. Now, currently, University of Malaya's Department of Faculty Alambina is building the State Management and Architecture Department, has a total staff of 115, of which 56 are PhD holders, approximately 50%. And Architecture Department itself, which would be, I suppose, the newest we could call to a creative department in UM, has a staff, a PhD complement of 11 of the 21 members of staff, approximately again 50%. Prof. Ken will remind you what, in fact, the percentage is in this faculty, roughly. We started with 2. I might add that I was one of the 2 PhDs, and the president was the other one in this faculty. So we've got astronomically from where we were at the outset of the university. My guess, and I think it's a pretty safe guess, is that by the year 2020, if you want to have a post as a lecturer in a university in Malaysia, you would have to be a PhD holder. And that looks like being inevitable. So I won't suggest that all staff in universities in Malaysia will have PhDs, but all new staff in Malaysian universities will have to have PhDs, otherwise you won't be appointed. Next slide, please. a little bit about research and teaching. When I left university, I was solely involved in research and development work. In fact, in the 1970s, there was a very clear distinction between what constituted research and what constituted development. My boss, Professor Ralph Galbraith Hopkinson, who was the Hayden Pilkington Chair of Building Physics at University College, had a very clear definition. Research is what universities do. Development is what I do in my private practice. That is, a very clear distinction between that work, which in fact was fundamental, and that which was directed in the sense that it was by application and usually by request. Now, that was one aspect of the work. The other aspect which in fact actually has influenced me immensely is that the multidisciplinary group I worked in really was genuinely multidisciplinary. It involved people who had background in architecture, people who had a background in psychology, people who had a background even in fact in American history. The appointments were on the basis of, you seem intelligent, I'm sure we can train you to do something very useful, rather than you come to us with a particular expertise. So it meant that in fact we had the ability to be very flexible in the research activity we undertook. That is, we were therefore involved in a lot of very original research. We in fact did the first environmental impact statement in the United Kingdom. We had a whole variety of things in the study. We studied complex design problems. The lighting of the London Stock Exchange is one of them. The lighting of the Stock Exchange in Dubai is also. These were in fact some of the things which in fact we looked at. So with flexibility I was taught there, and working in multidisciplinary teams. In three of my subsequent teaching appointments, I had to develop the syllabus for in each course I taught. In fact, in the case of the University of Malaya, I was responsible for developing the syllabus for the whole of the degree program. It taught me very much that in fact research, the necessity to research your subject area, is crucial for teaching. And I think the link between teaching and research is something which in fact we need to actually emphasize. All teachers have to be researchers. I think this is the case. To be successful, that in fact you need to be doing research. Students, I think, realistically can demand that their lecturers, in fact, are actively researching in the area in which they're teaching. My conclusion, therefore, is to be a good teacher, ultimately, you have to be an ardent researcher. That is, you cannot come into teaching, lecturing position in the university, and assume that, in fact, that what you know at entry is enough for you to actually continue to survive. You need to continuously refresh yourself with research activity. Okay. Motivation for research. Thank you for changing the slide. In the 1960s to the 90s, I would argue, from my experience, research in universities took place fundamentally because of self-motivation and curiosity on the part of the staff. That's why people did research. If you were commissioned to do research, it was because expertise was required outside. There was no sense of applying for government grants to do research. Please say, may I have some money to do some research? You sat there and waited until, in fact, they came to you and said, we have a problem, or we have an issue that we want you to research. And therefore, they came to you on the basis of your expertise, which was known. So research that was done in the universities was very much to do with developing expertise, because, in fact, research, external research, was requested by government agencies or maybe consultancies, but not, as it were, you as a member of staff in the university applying to do research for a government grant. They were, in fact, not the way in which research was carried out. So expertise was required, and also collaboration with other universities, which was very much more the case at that time. So the consequences were the development of expertise being most important, staff developing their expertise, in anticipation or not of, in fact, being used. One of the finest scholars in Victorian architecture in the UK at the University of Manchester said he could never see the point in getting a PhD. It was of no consequence to him. And so doing the research was the purpose of the exercise. So wider experience and collaboration. Modest use of university resources. This is a very interesting point. A lot of research that was carried at that time actually had no funding specifically. Maybe some casual funding on the part of the university. All equipment, well not all equipment, but large amounts of equipment were built directly by the technical staff in the university. So there was not large-scale funding. And I felt that, as I said earlier, that teaching and research were rather more in harmony. Can we go to the last slide there? So I see the motivation now in the slide. And this may be contentious in some people's views, but I think it actually states what the state of affairs is. Funding excellence is what we require nowadays in the university. To me, our ranking and KPI requirements, that is, because of the university ranking system, we have to have, as it were, funding for research. So research, funded research becomes quite crucial in that sense. And that's the first thing. Secondly, I think now you have to have a research passport, right, to acquire an appointment or promotion, right? And that research passport is actually PhD. So I think research excellence now is beginning to relate to money acquired to do that research. More expensive research being better research, and I dispute whether that's necessarily the same. But what it does mean to those of you who are thinking about possibly a career in an academic career, you have to recognize that you've got to get the passport. Now, those of you who are interested in getting the passport, you know, several of you here, who I can see you probably are ex-graduates or from other sources, please talk to any of the staff here about what you might like to research, how you might like to go about doing the research. This is a golden opportunity for you. There are many senior staff here, Dr. Ken, Dr. Koo. Those of you who are interested possibly in taught postgraduate courses, Madam Azliza is here, Dr. Forrest. There are several of them that you probably know from being lecturers. Now look at those staff from the point of view of being researchers or potential supervisors for your research. Okay. We're just running a little bit over time, and I'm told that in fact to take a couple of questions, but before I take any questions, can I just say one thing? Chances are that the questions you may have about research are ones which I cannot answer, such as, yeah, how much does it cost and how long does it take? So, those questions can be faced in this way. I believe we have somebody from marketing here today, is that correct? We have a representative from marketing, I think, is that correct? Outside. Anybody has questions about fees and reductions and the great deals the university will do for its ex-graduates, there is somebody from marketing who can tell you about that. Secondly, any questions about duration, etc. and so forth, the IPS, the Institute of Postgraduate Studies website contains all of that information. I think we may even have some brochures or a representative from IPS, if I'm not. Yes, we have a representative from IPS here as well. So those sorts of questions, I'm not the right person to answer, but then the person who is actually here. So, anybody has a quick question to answer?
All right, let me open the floor for Q&A. One or two questions will be good in the interest of time. Let me start by, whoever asks questions, go to the mic and you can start.
That's probably put your audience off.
The mic's getting red.
No?
Say your name.
I'm Zan from the ITM. I'd like to ask about the research for sports related to the educational background in Malaysia, which is in Malaysia we have requirements, which is you need to have a PhD in terms of what do you think in terms of the MFA programs that we have in in the US compared to the needs of PhD now in Malaysia in terms of ICNM, in terms of appointments and promotionals? Some of us have like MFA, which is a practice based master, which is, I would say, is actually a terminal degree for this program. Thank you.
There's an argument that does this equate to a PhD. I think in the past the universities took a very liberal view with regard to this. It's not just a problem in your university, it's a problem in our university as well. But I was addressing the issue of new staff. Now, the question of promotion of existing staff without a PhD, I think is actually problematic with that in this case. And frankly, I think the university has taken the view that in fact it will not get you promotion now having that degree. I suppose it's unfortunate. We do have, in fact, somebody in our presence who has both FA qualification and also PhD. And if I was being realistic, I'd have to say to you, you have to get the PhD, whether you think it's right or not. But the PhD, having been slightly cynical about, in fact, it being a passport, PhD is, in fact, actually a general route into research nowadays for most people. And developing a research expertise and excellence through the PhD is critical.
Can I add, actually, at one time, I think back in 2008, 2009, somewhere in the land document, they did say that it was the equivalent. But after when they changed that to MQA, it disappeared. So when we asked MQA any, how do you respond to that, they have not come.